What is up, my peeps from the intertubes? It is me, Caleb, from Caleb the Video Maker 2. And in this series, we are going to be talking about database clustering and managing those database clusters with a tool called cluster control. A database cluster, put simply, is when you have multiple computers that are all used to store your data. I've come up with four reasons why database clustering is a good thing. Those reasons are data redundancy, the good kind of data redundancy, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. Availability, scalability, and monitoring. Okay, I need spell check this time. The very first reason I got is data redundancy. Now, I've talked a lot about data redundancy in my videos, and all throughout one of my series, Database Design, I talk about how data redundancy is just really bad. But that is a different kind of data redundancy. That kind of data redundancy is when you have unnecessary duplicate data that can then, one can change and one can stay the same, for example, and then you have ambiguity because you don't know, are these two separate entries or are these talking about the same thing but one of them is incorrect, and it just gets really messy and confusing. Data redundancy when it comes to database clustering is a little bit different. So with database clustering, we are essentially using three computers to store our data. But how exactly is that data going to be stored? Are we going to store a third of the data on each one of these computers? Or are we going to store most of the data on one and then just some more important stuff on the others? Or what? Well, actually, we are going to have these synchronized to where all of the computers store the same information. That's a great thing because if one of these computers blows up, well, you still got two copies of the data. So this data redundancy is not a bad thing because everything is going to be synced or synchronized. What that means is as soon as there's a change on one of these computers, that change is going to propagate to all of the computers inside of this cluster. The data being synced this way gets rid of the risk of ambiguity because all of the data is going to be the same. Data redundancy is one of the features you're not going to be able to get if you're just using a standalone computer for all of your data. Because then, if this computer blows up, goodbye all your data. Or you're going to have to get regular backups and store them on a hard drive or on something else. But we don't want to do all that extra stuff. We just want it so where if something catastrophic happens, the data is not going to be deleted. And we don't have to worry about backing up data and all that stuff. I mean, obviously you should still back up your data, but there is a whole new layer of protection when you have a cluster. Now, when it comes to scalability, the thing I'm most particularly interested in is load balancing. What a load balancer does is it will take all of the incoming traffic, and then what it will do, so let's say this big bubble is our load balancer. What the load balancer will do is it will appropriately direct where the traffic should go, to which node it should go. And the benefit of that is, well, there's only one communication point to the database cluster right here. So it's easier for the programmer. The second thing is that the load balancer is not going to tax one particular computer too much. So you can just think of it as balancing the demands all across these different computers and not taxing one particular computer too much such that it slows down or explodes. Worst case scenario. When it comes to load balancing, though, it can be a little confusing because there's a lot of different competitors and options, so not all of them work exactly the same way. This is kind of just a general example that'll help you understand the concept of load balancing. And when it comes to scalability, what that means is that you can just expand the application very easily. If you're working with one computer, for example, and you just get like, boom, 4 million visitors, well, that might tax the system really bad. With a load balancer, those visits are going to be distributed, and when you have spikes of growth, your system is not pressured as much. Scalability and availability go hand in hand. Essentially, what availability is how much or how often your application or your database is available. How often are you able to use it, and how often is it broken? We want the availability to be as high as possible. So for example, let's say we have a 99% availability. Well, that seems pretty good. I mean, it's almost 100. But if you think about it, that means 1% of the time, your database is going to be unavailable. So if you think of 365 days in a year, 10% would be 36.5, 1% would be 3.65. So we're talking 3.5 days that your database is not going to be available. So 99% is actually a really bad value. How high of a number do you actually need? Well, that really depends on what the database is being used for and how many users you're going to be getting. For example, if a mom and pop shop can save some money by going to 99% and not paying extra for that extremely high availability, you know, 3.5 days down out of the year, you know, that's not that bad. But if you're like Google, like that's really not that good. Scalability comes in because if you're load balancing, you're going to make your availability much higher because, you know, this computer explodes, nothing breaks because, you know, you can communicate with this computer just the same. And with the load balancing, it understands all that, so it knows which computers to talk to. If you were just connecting directly to this database here, and then it breaks, well, that's not good because now, until it's fixed, your software system's not going to work. That's bad. The last thing is monitoring and automation. I kind of just clumped those together. So let's make sure we are all on the same page. When I'm talking about monitoring, I'm talking about looking at the health of your database system. You can do that manually, but there are a lot of tools out there to help you automate the process. So you can write scripts against your database cluster and say, hey, if this is going on, make sure you tell me because that's a big problem. And you can have these scripts run regularly, like once a week or once a day or every so often, and that'll just help you monitor the health of your database. Also with automation, another piece of automation is doing a lot of this database clustering. Onyx, would you be quiet? I am making a video. You can do a lot of this database clustering automatically with some of the software tools out there. For example, you can just say, hey, I want a load balancer, enable. Boom, you got a load balancer. That's all you gotta do. We will be getting into some of those tools. Until then, I just wanna talk about theory. So that's all I really gotta talk about in this video. The next couple videos will be some more informational stuff. And then what we're going to do is we're actually going to make a database cluster. And that's gonna be cool because then we can test stuff, you know, we can shut one down and see how things work and all that good stuff. So this series is going to be sick. And that's good, by the way. Kind of a dumb slang term because sick is like a bad thing, but when you say something sick, somehow it's a good thing, but who knows. So just as some extra information to help you get through the series the best, I am going to have a study guide available at the end of this video and also in the description probably. In addition to that, I'm going to have extra information on my website, calebcurry.com, which you can probably find in the description, assuming I don't forget to put it there. Also, the company that is helping me make these videos is called Several Nines. They are the ones that have made some of this database clustering software, and they decided that they wanted to help support my channel. So that is really great for me, and it's also great for you because I can make more content. So if you appreciate these videos, go check out their stuff, and obviously we're gonna check it out because we're gonna be using their stuff throughout this series. But I encourage you to go to them and say, hey, I saw you from Caleb Video Maker 2. You should pay him tons of money. You know, that helped me out. So yeah, guys, that's all I got. Please, please, please remember to subscribe to this channel because there's gonna be lots of great new content coming out. And I'm also going to go back and finish my C programming series. I know, I'll get to it, just relax. So stay tuned. And one last thing, check out the newsletter. That will be used to give you guys notifications of cool new stuff going on with Caleb the Video Maker 2. And lastly, follow me on social networks and all that good stuff. All right, that's enough advertising for like a week. I will see you guys in the next video. Hopefully this was helpful. If you have any questions at all, please leave them in the description. Leave them as a comment, and I will see if I can help you out. Thanks, and I'll see you in the next one.